Welcome to Recollections, the Middle Tennessee Voices of Their Time series. A look at the past through the experiences of Middle Tennesseans. I'm Bob Bullen of Middle Tennessee State University, along with my guest, Fayne Haynes of Murfreesboro, the epitome of the American businessman, self-made American businessman and citizen soldier. A genuine World War II combat veteran, Fayne Haynes fought with his unit, the 612th Tank Destroyer Battalion, Company B, all the way from Omaha Beach to the Battle of the Bulge. 6 months without any relief on the front lines. In a last desperate battle stand in a small town in Belgium, Sergeant Haynes was captured and spent 4 months in a POW camp in Germany. At that point, he made a daring escape towards the end of the war and was finally rescued by the British. All in all, it's a very remarkable war story. He returned to Murfreesboro to become one of the more successful businessmen in Middle Tennessee. Fayne, Germany is reunited and the Germans are very much in the picture today. What feelings do you have towards the German people?
Well, Bob, I never had too much problem with the Germans. I think the German people as a whole are very fine people. I think mostly they were misled by Hitler, and of course, I wasn't too fond of his SS troops that that we encountered in that Panzer tank units, but I think the German people are, as a whole, good type people.
How do you see Germany in the future since it's been reunited?
I think the German are very smart people. I think they're very progressive people, and they are very thorough with anything they do. They're manufacturing, and they, even during the war, they had very fine guns that German 88 was hard to deal with. And I think the Germans can build a lot of quality merchandise, and I think that will help them in the future.
Of course, you've gone to many reunions with your group, but occasionally on TV we see German units having a reunion, even some SS units in Germany. What feelings do you have when you see those German soldiers, old soldiers, coming together again?
Well, I wouldn't like for us to let them get out of hand again. I think we need to check them very quickly if they do begin to get out of hand. But that was traditional with the Germans that I saw them from little bitty kids on up goose-stepping and training in doing the war there. And they were pretty much indoctrinated by Hitler.
So you think that that's in the German people, that could happen again in the future?
I think so. Of course, if you study, Hitler did a lot for Germany economy and things for a while. When he took over, Germany was pretty bad condition. I had a book, that Progress of Dutchland, that I had picked up in Germany that I was able to look over, and they had made great strides.
Let's go back to your early life and early times. You came up in the Depression, came from a humble background, had a lot of brothers, and you really had to scrap and dig to make it through those early years. You had to stop school after the eighth grade. So tell me about your early days, starting with that two-room school that you went to.
Well, I might say first, Bob, that I started the school at Christiana, and they had a little more than two rooms at Christiana the first 3 years. After that, I moved to a school at Harts Chapel, which is no longer there, across from the airport close to Shelbyville. And there was a two-room school there, and then I later moved to Deason, which had a two-room school there. And there was two teachers. One teacher taught the first four grades, and then the other one taught the next four grades. And I'd say they did a very good job.
Was discipline good in the school?
Discipline was very good. They did, I think, a good job with the discipline.
You've always had a knack for tinkering, inventing things, and you seem to have quite a bit of skill in the business world. You started quite early working with your brother Buford in his store. Give me the background on that.
Yeah, I helped him there, and talking about tinkering and carpenter, things like that. Even in grammar school, the teachers had me building little things or doing repair or painting at the school, at the two-room school there. But My brother there in the store, he started in a very small way, too. He didn't have anything. See, we were sharecroppers on the farm, and we never owned any land or anything, and things was tough during the Depression. But right after the Depression, he managed to get started in this little grocery store, and he had built up to a big general merchandise store, and I helped him in the general merchandise store while I was growing up.
By the time you were 17, you had a truck route. How did that happen?
Well, I was running a peddling truck, as a lot of them call it, or a rolling store out through the country, and we would load up the rolling store there at the grocery store, and I had shelves in it and everything fixed up real neat. And we would go out and from house to house out through the country and back in around Bell Buckle and back out in the hollows of like Hatchet Holler, Punching Camp Holler, and all these places. And at that time, most of them didn't have electricity. They didn't have any electricity in those hollows, and they didn't, a lot of them didn't even have cars. So they were very proud to see a truck roll up with groceries that they could eat. And I had a complete line of groceries.
You built an ice box into that truck.
I had an ice box. I think I was about the only one that had an ice box, and I carried cold drinks. I had the regular block ice in there, and I had cold drinks, bologna and cheese and things of that type on the truck.
I thought it was interesting that you had somewhat of what I'd call an egg exchange. Could you briefly touch on that?
Yeah, we bought lots of eggs. Eggs was, to us, a source of money, and we sold them for the same price that we gave for them. Most of the time, a part of the time, they were 13 cents a dozen. Then they went to 12 cents a dozen, and some people were complaining because it went down, and I said, well, that's not all bad. 12 cents a dozen, that makes them a penny a piece, and it's easier for me to count that way.
Well, you went on into the trucking business, I believe, when you were 19. Tell me about buying your first truck and how you paid for that.
Well, in running this peddling truck, I had made barely enough to buy me a car. I had a 35 Chevrolet car, and I took it and traded it in on the truck. 1.5-ton Chevrolet heavy-duty truck. And
that was a 42 model, wasn't it?
From 1942. And I brought it home. I brought it back up to Deason, just the chassis with no bed and no money. I bought the lumber on the credit under my brother's name to build the body with. And I got one of the neighbors to help build it, and I helped him build part of it. And we got the foundation built on it where I could haul Lespedeza seed, and this was in the fall of the year. And I started hauling while he was building the sides to it. And while he was building the sides, I had made enough from my hauling to pay him for building my body. So I did rather well.
You put on quite a few miles that 1 year, didn't you?
I did 50,000 miles on this truck that 1 year. And of course, some of them was long trips and all, but a lot of them was just short trips hauling corn and hay and things that you don't put much mileage on it, but you do a lot of work.
I understand you had a motto.
Yeah, my motto was, see, I wasn't married at that time. My motto was that I'd haul anything, any place, at any time.
And that included some horses to Louisiana, didn't it?
I carried horses to Louisiana. I carried six of the fine Allen stock walking horses from Shelbyville to Luling, Louisiana, right outside of New Orleans. And non-stop from, just stopped long enough to eat, didn't unload them or anything, pulled them all away, about 600 miles.
Speaking of horses, you were at the first walking horse show in Shelbyville?
I was at the first walking horse show in 1939.
You have any vivid memory of that?
Yeah, Strolling Jim won this walking horse show there, and He came from out War Trace, you know. They took him out from a plow out at War Trace and made a walking horse, and he became world champion. And I remember that real well. I was running this peddling truck in around War Trace, so I was very well acquainted with that. I were 18 years old, I believe, when the walking horse celebration started.
Where were you on Pearl Harbor Day? What do you remember about that?
Well, I didn't remember too much about the Pearl Harbor Day. I remembered it, but, you know, like most kids, I never thought about going to the war or anything, and hadn't thought anything about it.
You got a shock on that a little bit later, didn't you?
I did get a shock on that. I married in October the 3rd, 1942, and 3 months later, I was in the Army. And when I married, I hadn't even registered for the Army and hadn't even thought about going in the Army.
That's an interesting story about you wore out a set of tires on your truck and you thought you'd go to the tire board and get another one. And Mr. Eblin in Shelbyville was in charge of the tire board and, I believe, the draft board. So tell me that story.
Yeah, I was about to get the tires. They said, yeah, you qualify. You haul farm products and all. Said, you qualify for a new set of tires. They were about to issue me a set, and Mr. Eblin walked up, and he, as you said, he was on both boards, and he said, just a minute, I'm not for sure if this boy needs any tires or not. Let me go check my list on the draft board. He come back, said, no, said, you don't need any tires. Said, the Army's going to furnish you tires. Said, you be called in the next 2 or 3 days. So I got my notice in the next 2 or 3 days.
And they sent you to Camp Forest for a physical?
I'd had a physical at Camp Forest.
You came out of that pretty well, didn't you?
Yeah, the officer there looking over his papers, and he looked up at me, and he said, boy, you just the kind we're looking for. Said, there's absolutely nothing wrong with you. And said, you're the right size and everything. Said, we'd like you to report for active duty in 7 days.
So they gave you 7 days to get to Fort Oglethorpe in Georgia.
They gave me 7 days to wind up my business. I had to call and cancel hauling trip that I had planned and didn't have time to sell my truck.
That's a good story about human nature there on your truck. People sort of like wolves sometimes when they see somebody has to make immediate arrangements to go somewhere else. People wanted your truck badly, didn't they?
I had two people that already told me if I went in the Army, they wanted to buy my truck. And I said, okay. So I went to one of them, and he offered me half what I wanted for it. He said, well, I thought you'd have to sell it. And I said, no, I don't have to sell it. I've already paid for the truck. I let it sit there and rust down before I sell it for any less. I went to the other one. It was the same story. He was wanting to buy it for about half price. And I sold the truck for $1,000. They was asking me $500 for it. And it was a beautiful truck, didn't have a scratch on it, and it never was involved in any kind of accident, and it was pretty and shiny. It was black. It was a beautiful truck. They had this lacquer paint they used back in those days. They put a good paint job on them.
How'd you finally sell the truck?
I left it with my brother and told him, somebody come along, want it for $1,000, sell it to him. If it didn't, just let it sit there. And just in a short time, some fellow from Tullahoma came over, and he was buying it to haul garbage from Tullahoma, from the camp over there, and feed his hogs so he could qualify for tires. And so he said, yeah, he'd just love to have the truck. So he bought it without any question. Well, he didn't even drive the truck. He told my brother asked him if he didn't want to drive it. He said, no. Nah. Said, if he kept the outside of this truck looking that well, he surely took care of the motor. So he bought it right off.
Well, your life took a dramatic turn when you arrived at Fort Oglethorpe. Let's trace through your training and what happened to you in basic training and how you became a weapons expert. And all of this training really lasted quite a while. How long? 16 months, somewhere along there?
We trained about 16 months in Texas and then 2 months on Louisiana maneuvers.
I guess in one respect that would show that America was confident they were going to win the war if they would take that long to prepare people to go to combat.
Well, they didn't do that altogether, Bob. There was people that went into the infantry in combat. Some of them come into combat with only 2 months of training over there. And I saw some of them had come over there as replacements on up right before the Battle of the Bulls. They were taking people with very little training and sending them over. I saw one officer, he drawed a bunch of young replacements and he just cried before he carried them into combat. He said they don't last no time. Said they're not trained and they're too young.
Well, that's what makes your story remarkable. You did last and you're here today to tell about it. So
yeah,
let's talk about your basic training. Was that on the Texas coast?
Well, it was at Brownwood, Texas, down on the coast. Not Brownsville. A lot of people think of Brownsville, but this was Brownwood down on the coast. And it was Camp Bowie was the name of the camp there. It was a temporary camp. I'm sure it was folded up quickly after the war.
You were selected to go to a special weapons course.
That's true. After we finished basic, we moved to Fort Hood, and we did a lot of advanced training at Fort Hood, their tactical training. Then they sent us to Camp Swift over near Austin, Texas. And it was while we were there at Austin, Texas, when we just had arrived there, hadn't been there long, that they decided to send one man from each line company, which was three men out of the battalion, to this special school for weapons and gunnery school. And so I was selected from my company, B Company, to go to this school. It was an 8-week special crash course. Now, if all the things they tried to teach us, we couldn't have learned it in 8 weeks if it had not been that we'd already been in the Army 8 months and studying a lot of these things already, you see. And our day started early and quit late at this school. And what we learned there, I were to go back and teach my company the things that I learned there. And I held classes on all kinds of guns after I got back until we...
By this time, you were assigned to the tank destroyer unit?
I was in the tank destroyer unit from the very outset.
Okay.
My commanding officer was Colonel Heading, was a World War I tank commander, and he was a World War II tank destroyer commander.
So he was an older fellow with considerable experience.
I estimated that he was probably 55 years old, and he led us on 25-mile hikes out around Austin and 100-degree temperature.
Did he go to Europe with you?
He made every step. He did not go to Europe. The Army told him he couldn't go on account of his age. He wasn't going. They wouldn't let him go in combat on account of his age, and he cried like a baby.
Well, let's get it clarified that you were a sharpshooter, an expert with a submachine gun, and other small weapons, and that's one of the things that you're really quite proud of, your gunnery ability. What do you attribute that to?
Well, I don't know. I think probably steady nerves was the probably the key to that. I don't know. Some people have a knack for more accuracy than others, apparently.
Fort Hood was the major training base for the tank destroyer.
All tank destroyer. That was tank destroyer headquarters. Of course, we had more at other areas out training too, but that was the headquarters, and might say that one time we changed camp commanders there, and we was on parade down by the viewing stand through the main street. We had 60,000 tank destroyers on parade at one time.
An impressive sight.
Impressive sight, and we got hot. The weather had warmed up a little bit in the spring, and we was in full military uniform.
Well, you lived a charmed life surviving all these things, but you got your first chance to find out what survival was like on going on maneuvers in a Louisiana swamp. You wrecked a Jeep down there, didn't you?
Yeah, I wrecked a Jeep down there. And I wasn't even supposed to be a driver, but the lieutenant had asked me to drive the Jeep to see if I couldn't move a little faster than my driver was moving. And I was moving fast, all right, but I was going through weeds about high as your head, and you couldn't see nothing. You got right up on this. Then I run into a little creek there with the banks straight up about 3 foot high on both sides. So there was nothing me to do but to crash.
Well,
I had two boys. I picked up these machine guns, and we were moving out. These tank destroyers, you know, that we had was self-propelled. They could move out in just no time flat. All of theirs was already loaded, you know. But I had to go out and pick up these machine guns and riflemen and stuff, and we had a 6x we was hauling them in, and I had a Jeep. And I had these two men on this Jeep, in the Jeep with a machine gun on the back. When I hit this ditch, they come over the Jeep. Of course, the windshield was already down on the Jeep. They come over it, never even touched the Jeep, and landed out in the front with a machine gun.
Well, that was just getting...
Didn't even hurt them.
That's just getting you ready for what was to come shortly. Now, you moved on to New Jersey. Tell me about the crossing to Scotland. They took you from New Jersey across the Atlantic to Scotland. Tell me how you went and what happened on that 7-day, we'll call it a cruise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a pretty good cruise. The first thing from New Jersey, they put us on a ferry and ferried us across to the ship. And we went up the gangplank on this ship and loaded aboard it, and they have never told us where we were going. We had no idea, and they never did tell us where we was going. Even after we got underway, they still didn't tell us. But as we were going almost there, we could see one little body of land in the far distance, a few hills, and there was one Irishman aboard. He said, "You can't fool an old Irishman." Said, "That's the shores of Ireland." We found out later, sure enough, it was the shores of Ireland, but we went on and went into Glasgow, Scotland, went into the port there. This ship was a big ship. We had 14,000 troops on the ship.
What was the name of the ship?
The Elder France.
14,000 on there.
Yeah. This ship was a very interesting thing. It was at one time a French luxury liner. It was built in Hamburg, Germany. I went down to inspect the engine room, and it had great big German swastikas built into the motor, the metal swastikas made into the motor. And it was a very powerful ship, the most powerful going, and it was one of the few that could travel alone.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
It traveled faster than most ships. The reason it could go alone, it had its own battle guns, and it had its own radar and depth charges and everything to protect itself.
Were you worried about submarines?
Yeah, everybody was at that time because we was losing a lot of ships to the German submarine fleet. And we would put a little fear into us at night when we'd see this ship change course. We'd know then it was going around a submarine. But our defense on that was that the ship could outrun a submarine, so they just merely went around the submarines. They did that several times going overseas.
Your unit was put to work on the ship, wasn't it?
Yeah, my commander volunteered us to do the labor. Our cooks was cooking, and we were handling supplies, and for a few days I helped carry 100-pound bags of potatoes from the top deck down about two or three flights of steps to the kitchen. The ship reeling around, you know, it had you rocking around a little bit. But I was fortunate, and I didn't get sick like a lot of the boys going over on it. But later they put me in the kitchen to making coffee, and I had a snap there.
You drink coffee now?
I don't drink coffee now. Mayo Clinic took me off of coffee, but I did drink some then. But this coffee was easier to make. We used a gallon of coffee grounds in each urn, and we had two urns, one on each side.
Another human interest story, shows what people do when they are in need and desperate. When you arrived in Scotland, the British, we won't say stole goods off the ship, but they were interested in getting the fruit and other things that were not available in Great Britain at that time. Tell me what happened there and how that worked.
Yeah, I had got acquainted with a lot of the British, you know, and in handling supplies and stuff on the ship there, and I could talk to them pretty confidentially. And so just about 3 days before we landed, they began to cart stuff into these cabins, their own personal cabins on this ship, and a lot of fruit and things like that. And I said, "Hey, buddy, what's going on here? Why all this food being put in the cabins and all?" He said, "Oh, there's no secret about that, old chap." He said, "Most people know what we do on that." Said, "We can't get fruit and things like that at home. And we load that off, and they allow us to ship it. From Glasgow, they shipped it to their home back in England, all on the same body of land, you know, and they could ship it by rail." And so that's what they did. When it landed, these little boats was just coming around the sides of it like bees, and they was loading this stuff off over the sides. The reason I saw so much of that, they put us over the side too, because the ship couldn't get up to the dock. It had to dock out. It was so big it couldn't get up to the up real close to in the harbor. And they ferried us on in on a smaller craft, and they just took, though I was selected to stay there to look after our supplies and stuff. And
so you were, out of 14,000, you were one, I believe, of 105 that were left to unload the ship.
Yeah, yeah. Out of our battalion of 1,000 people, they selected me, and I couldn't figure that out hardly, because I was not in headquarters company or supply company either. I was down in B company as a gunner, and they picked me to stay there and look after our supplies, and I was take 5 men out of my squad and unload there. So we did, and I were to help check the supplies off of the ship, and the other men was to do the labor.
Now, when you landed, you did get a chance to send a telegram home.
Yeah, we did, and I might say in the landing, it was very colorful. They had a Scottish band to meet us there in their skirts, their plaid skirts.
Kilts, I believe.
Kilts, yeah. And they was just real colorful. And I was amazed at the train. They had just little compartments. You didn't go from one car to the other. And when they stopped, everybody just jumped out of it at one time, and you could load just that quick on it.
So from Scotland, you took the train to England.
Well, we first took a train from there over to Glasgow a piece, not very far, and then it hauled us by truck onto the Hotspur transit camp, and we stayed there a week. My battalion went on down into England, and we stayed there at Glasgow for a week until our supplies was all loaded on a train and the seals put on it and shipped. And then we boarded a train. I didn't know where we was going then, but we had one officer in charge, and he told us, you know, when to go. And I was somewhat amazed. Along in the morning, we left about dark. He woke me up, and he said, Haynes said, everybody's unloaded now. Said, I'm unloading here with my crew. And said, you're the last group to unload. Said, here's your traveling orders. And said, you're on your own. And he said, when you get to this next town over here, said, you get off there at Bristol, England, and you'll inquire about this certain officer there, and he will tell you where your unit is. So we still didn't, they didn't give us any information ahead of time. That was how secretly things was moving.
Well, your unit,
I found that my unit was only 6 miles out from Bristol.
Well, your unit was destined for the invasion. Did you know at that time that your unit was being prepared for the big invasion of Europe?
I didn't know ahead of time. However, the first day that we were in the 612 tank destroyers, old commander told us that we were being trained for combat. We might as well to get that in our head to start with.
Well, this was the spring of 1944. You were in England, and what happened that month or two before the June invasion? What type of maneuvers or what type of training did you go through?
Bob, when we landed when we got off of the train at Bristol, England, that's when I had to contact this S officer there, and he told us where our unit was, and we found out it was 6 miles out from Bristol, and we was going to have 2 or 3 hour layover. So I got a sergeant I called, and he come and picked us up, and then we joined our unit there in Bristol.
Did you get to mix with the British people any during this time?
We did some while we were there for the 2 months there. We mixed with them some. Not a great deal, but we did mix with them some.
Did our boys get to see the English girls very much?
Some of them probably did. I were married, but we didn't have any free time much. I mean, so far as we didn't get to go into town. and things like that. We were training all the time we were there.
June 6, 1944 was D-Day. As you approached June 6, did you have a feeling that something big was about to happen? What was the morale, the feeling in the ranks at this time?
Well, we knew that, of course, something was going to happen, that we were waiting there for that. But I might say before I get into that, that we had been training there. We had not been, we trained for direct fire, for knocking out tanks, pillboxes, and things like that. They said, well, we might need you to lay artillery, and we'd not been trained to lay artillery. So the 2 months we was in England, we were trained a full course on laying artillery with these guns. And we fired on a British firing range there to learn to lay artillery. And we did master the laying the artillery. But before we went to the marshalling area, they had had us to waterproof our guns and our half tracks. So we knew from that that we were going in. We was getting ready to ford the water on a beach landing. So we were sitting, had already moved to the marshalling area, right across from England, right at the English Channel there, at Southampton. And we were waiting there at Southampton for the invasion.
On June 6th, the first day of the invasion, what do you remember and what did you see?
What I remember more than anything else was that early that morning, the plane started coming over us. They just almost shattered the earth. Everything was shattered from these planes. Just one wave after another was going across the English Channel. They was coming right over us on a continuing flow. And one thing was a little exciting for us. One of the planes that was pulling a glider, the cable snapped, and he landed right next to us in the field, right next to us. And we helped to guard the plane while, and by the way, when he landed, immediately, they wheeled out of there with a jeep, out of the glider, and was ready to go back to the base, you know, to tell them that they'd had a mishap, I guess. So we guarded the plane.
Those guys were geared up for immediate combat.
Yeah. When he landed, the nose dropped down, and he come out of it with a jeep right away. That was better than going into combat with getting out of it, though. We was more calm than they was later.
You had to wait 7 days to cross, and when you did, you had quite an exciting crossing. Tell me about the boat you went in and what happened that first night, and you headed for Omaha Beach, which was one of the most destructive areas, an area where fierce fighting took place. You went right into the heart of the battle.
Yeah, we went over, and as I say, it's about 21 miles. It's not too far across the English Channel, but it was very choppy, and we got there late in the afternoon, about night, and the tide was not right, apparently, and we stayed outside in the channel all night. And the next morning, when the tide started going in, well, we went in with the tide on the beaches there.
What type of boat was that you spent
the night? It was LST. The front end of them, you know, dropped down, and you drive right out. Now, we had our vehicles, these half tracks, towing these big guns, all on this boat. And I might say that our company, B Company, was the advanced element of our battalion. We went 3 days before the rest of the battalion did in the invasion. And we landed, and the British was manning the LSTs. And the first gun crew that went off with his half track, he hit the water and he began to sink, and he went all the way down till he too far and drowned him out, because it was a big bum crater there that we had no idea was under the water, you know. So they backed the ship up, the boat back, and pulled over a little bit, and the rest of us went right on in without any problem.
I read about those bomb craters, and a lot of people were lost in those things, soldiers and equipment.
Yeah. It just sunk down too far. We had them waterproof where they could run under about 3 foot of water, but that was just too deep.
Were you sick when you landed? Were you seasick when you
landed? I was not seasick. Some of my boys was seasick and couldn't eat, but I don't know. I guess I could always eat. and I was still, was not seasick when I landed.
Well, let's follow this through in some type of sequence. What did you see immediately when you hit the beach?
The first thing I saw when we were going on the beach was an officer, a tank destroyer officer that I'd never seen in my life before. I don't know how he got there, but he was already there. And he said, "How quick can you get these guns ready to fire?" I said, "It'd be about 2 hours at the best." We had this old cosmoline grease on the guns and the half tracks to keep them waterproof where we could bring them in without damage. And it took us about 2 hours to get those waterproof. Then after that time, they put us immediately on the front line. They said they were desperate for firepower.
By front line, how far up the beach did you go?
They had pushed in just far enough that to where the battleships could not give them any support, you know. And the artillery had not landed, so they desperately needed firepower. And they took half of our company, which had 12 units, 12 big guns, and we lost one, so it just left us 11. They took about half of them for direct fire, and the other half were laying artillery.
Did you see a lot of destruction as you went to the front?
All kinds of destruction everywhere you looked, of course, there on the beaches and off of the beaches there, too. Of course, the infantry made the invasion, you know, an immediate invasion, and the beaches first, and secured the area to where we could get in with these big guns. But they had no artillery, had not landed at that time, and so my gun was one that was selected to lay artillery. So the first 10 days, we laid artillery, and for my gun alone, I laid 1,001 round. And the other guns did the same. We all fired at the same amount there. We were firing at night, all night, harassing fire.
I want to talk about your guns more in just a minute, but yours is a heroic story, and I know you're a very brave man, but what were you thinking when you went ashore? You could obviously see the destruction, and you knew you were going in literally into the pit of hell. And what went through your mind as you moved to the front?
Well, I don't know. I just, we were just doing our job, and that's what we were sent there to do, and we just pushed ahead and didn't. I tried not to think too much about it.
You were almost too busy to think about it.
I tried to think about what I was going to do and just ignored the danger, I guess, in it. And I did that, I think, all the way through because my commanding officer once told one of the other commanders he thought I had nerves of steel. He said he'd never seen me when I was rattled or could not function, said I was always able to function.
Well, you mentioned having to fire the gun. You're up at night, firing at night. Describe the weapon that you're using. I think our listeners need to have a better perception of that.
Well, it was, most of them call it a 3-inch gun. Actually, it was a 76.2 millimeter gun. And it was a very effective gun. That was really the key to the tank destroyers, was this one particular gun. Before, we had not had a gun that would knock out a German tank. It did not have enough striking power. This gun, although about a 3-inch gun, and the shell was pretty good sized shell, but the thing, it had so much powder charge that it traveled so fast, it traveled in speed 5,280 feet per second. So that's a little over a mile a second. And the sheer speed gave it a tremendous striking power. We could penetrate steel with it without any problem and penetrate these tanks. And then we also had concrete piercing shells that we could penetrate supposedly 6 foot of reinforced concrete. Then we had high explosive shells that would take care of personnel. And then we had a phosphor shell, a tracer shell, that we would fire if we wanted to set something on fire. We could set a house or something on fire and we burn them down with this.
Now this 3-inch gun, when you're talking about 3-inch, you're talking about the
diameter of the shell.
All right, how much did that shell weigh, you think?
Oh, about 20 pounds, probably, 25.
And you could use that. You could use that gun two ways. Am I correct? You could aim straight ahead for about 4,200 yards, is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
and you could use it elevated as an artillery piece and fire approximately 8 miles.
Yeah, that is correct. Of course, it wasn't hardly that simple. We had to change sights. We had one sight, a lensetic sight that we used to fire direct fire, which was a three-power scope, which we would magnify what we was looking at through the sight three times, which was a big help to us. And then the other sight that we had was a panoramic sight, just like they use in artillery. And it quite a bit, as some of these artillery people might tell you, artillery is quite involved, and they had to be set up a certain way and coordinated with the map and everything else, you know.
So you had spotters called your positions for you?
Oh, yeah. Everything was, we fired at night under total darkness. Everything was being used by map and things like that, and targets had been picked out ahead.
Were you fairly accurate at 7 or 8 miles?
They said we were real accurate. Said there was, they thought our guns was really more accurate than the artillery pieces for laying artillery.
Could this gun move and fire at the same time?
Well, no, this was a towed gun. We towed it with a half track.
Okay, you had to stop and dig in?
No, oh yeah, we would move in and dig in ahead of time. If it had to be set up, of course, for the artillery, it took a while to set it up to lay the artillery.
You had to dig in?
It had to dig in. It had spades on the end of the trails to where it would dig into the ground, you know, and give itself footing there where it would hold. When you'd fire, once it got dug in, it would stay put. It'd buck up at the front end. It'd jump off the ground.
You had a strong recoil when it fired?
It had a 36-inch recoil, and it had a big spring, a equilibrator spring, that would stretch back, and then the spring was strong enough to pull it back in place after each round.
How many men on a gun?
We had a 10-man crew. We had a sergeant and a corporal and 8 crew members.
What about your ears? Did it make a loud noise?
It made the worst noise you'd ever heard, that keen clap of, just like a clap of lightning each time it fired, and it devastated your ears. We did not use earplugs because we had to be able to hear. We had telephone communication, and we had earphones on that we used for communication, and we couldn't use that, and firing so much, it just would devastate your ears. It would.
We're having a normal conversation here. Obviously, your ears weren't damaged much.
Well, you know, you have two sets of hearing, one for voice and one for high notes. And according to Mayo Clinic, and they've checked it twice up there, my ears is out 75% on high notes. But voice, I can hear very well. I have a problem if it was, a motor, a fan, or other noise would detract from the voice, would interfere sometimes. But my ears is almost gone on that. And I have a lot of ringing in my ears, and I still have some swelling in my ears. I have had ever since the war, but I've been able to function all the time, so I can't complain too much.
Let's describe this. You were really involved in the next 30 or days, so in a fierce battle that's known as St. Lo, and of course that was a great breakout for our troops when St. Lo was finally captured. But talk about those 30 days there. That was a period of time the heat was intense. You had to dig in. You couldn't move the dead. Give me a description of everything that went on during those 30 days.
Yeah, it was about the worst, I guess, probably I'd seen. Maybe not so much destruction, but the conditions and everything there. And I might say that St. Lo was the last major stronghold that they had in Normandy. And once we broke them out there at St. Lo, you see, Patton came in just as we finished breaking out there. And I'd say we'd been there about, we'd been to St. Lo for 30 days, and we was there some at another position. So we'd been there a month and a half or more, I guess. And they just didn't want to give up at all. We just kept bombarding them, and they used our unit to help lay artillery on them for a little while there. And then they had us to pull up for some direct fire, too, to help blast them out. And once we got them blasted out there and had them on the run, then Patton came in. He just had come in on the beaches. He just had arrived with new tanks and new troops. And he took over from us and pushed them while he was on the run, and he overcome most of these people fleeing and trying to get away. He overcome them on the road, and they machine gunned a lot of them, and the Air Force was very active, and the Air Force caught a lot of them, and there was so many hundreds and hundreds of dead Germans and dead horses and cows and things in the road and vehicles that we had to detour around some of these roads to get on through.
But during that, I want to talk about that 30 days a little bit more. You had to dig in there, and you couldn't maneuver very much in that 30 days, could you?
Yeah, one of the places that I had dug in there, it was right in this little valley, and there's hills all the way around us, and it was hot, it was humid. And to start with, when we set up, we had to pull several Germans. We take them by the boots and pull them back, dead soldiers, back out of our way to set our guns up. And it was a dead cow in the front of us. It was smelling awful bad. And nobody had been picked up for the last 10, 12 days. Not even Americans or German dead was all still laying there. It was so critical in that area that the evacuation people could not get in there and pick them up. And they just let them lay until the battle pushed on, and then they come in and cleaned up after we left.
I want people to have a vivid picture of what this was like, since you experienced 6 months of direct combat. You had no chance much to clean up or change of uniform or much of anything, did you?
We didn't have any at all, and while we were there, the odor was so bad that you could never get a fresh breath. And one time I remember the wind started blowing a little from one direction. I could see it blowing in the trees. I said, oh, we're going to get a good fresh breath of air. Well, it smelled just as bad as the other, so still it was no relief from that at all. It just made you sick where you could barely eat the odor that we had to endure, and that went on for at least 10 days or more there at that one particular point.
Were you shelled by the Germans any?
Oh, yeah, we had artillery falling around all time in there, and where my gun was, it was out from the outpost. We could not see anybody else. We couldn't even hear them when they moved out or nothing. We had to be, our communication at that time with the rest of our unit was a runner.
You were mixed in with the infantry up at the very front, is that correct?
Yeah, we was. We always would set up out front with the infantry to support the infantry. We brought that out more vividly down in Brest, France, after we got on down into.
But this was Brest, the beginning France. Of what is known in the military textbooks as hedgerow fighting?
Yeah, the hedgerows was very bad to get through. A hedgerow, Bob, most of them was anywhere from 4 to 5 foot tall. The dirt was 4 or 5 foot high, and trees growing out the top of the dirt, and some of them would be from anywhere from 3 to 6 foot across, wide.
I read where these things had been built up through the centuries, so the roots were interlocking, and the road was literally a sunken road, and the hedgerows were up above you. Is that correct?
Yeah. The only way to get into these fields would be through a gate. You know, they'd have a gate going into each field. But in crossing these areas, the infantry and all could not go through gates all the time. So we developed a thing, and they took some big vehicles, big tanks, and put a blade on them like a bulldozer, and pushed through these hedgerows. And when it pushed through, the infantry would follow right in behind the tanks. That's how they were breaking through some of those hedgerows. That's how they was getting
I read through. That we put something, some sergeant invented an idea of something like an elephant tusk or something on the front of a lot of our tanks to clear through there.
It was more like, I'd say more like a blade, like a bulldozer blade on the front of them, and they just, they acted like a bulldozer. Of course, it was stationary. What they put on there was stationary, and it was stuck out in the front.
Could you ever see German tanks? Could you ever see German tanks where you were firing away?
Oh, I saw a lot of German tanks, yeah.
Could you see the German infantry out in front of you occasionally?
Yeah, we could see the infantry at times when we were set up our guns. We could see the infantry, and I'd watch them through my field glasses around pillboxes and stuff. And at times, and We'd watch them in pillboxes, and we were not allowed to fire a shot. We didn't even fire on them until the infantry would attack, and then we'd come alive then later on that.
Now, when you were in this area, you used sandbags quite a bit, and you had to dig in.
We used sandbags a lot to put around our guns to protect us from small fire, and also an artillery shell that would land close to you. It would help from the shrapnel from that by putting sandbags.
When you first saw some of your comrades being wounded or killed, what thoughts went through your mind?
Well, of course, you know, we never like to lose anybody. One of my worst experiences, I guess, was when I lost my gun sergeant after about 2 months in combat. He was hit by artillery, and we evacuated him out. And at that time, I took over his job and my job, too. For the next 4 months, I did the sergeant's job and the corporal's job. And our officers was well aware of it, but they said that they had talked about it and said I'd done such a good job on the gun, said there was no way they was going to take me off of the gun, and said they thought if they brought a sergeant in, he'd be in my way. So they said that they thought I was big and strong and I could handle it by myself, said I'd done fine. But they made this decision after our first battle at St. Lo, which I fired tremendously the same afternoon after our sergeant was hit about noon that day, and the battle started immediately after that. And they said I functioned so well that afternoon, they didn't see no problem, so they wasn't going to put nobody else in my crew.
One of the problems you had from German shell fire was hitting the trees and coming down on top of you.
That was really a bad situation. Now, I learned that at St. Lo. We went around these hills and we looked at some of the dead, just hundreds of American soldiers, and some of them laying in their foxholes, thought they were safe, and the shrapnel had hit in the trees and come down on them and killed them right there in their foxholes. And that gives you a pretty quick education on that. So after that, I told my crew, I said, whenever possible, we will cover our foxholes over with something. And we did after that cover over. One night I covered mine, Bob, it may seem a little cruel, but we pulled up crosses off out of the cemetery. It was right in the side, beside of a cemetery, pulled up the crosses, put that across the foxhole, and they had a rock fence around it with big slabs on the top of it, and a slate slabs on top. We took that off and put over top of these crosses to make a cover for our foxhole.
Well, you shouldn't feel bad about that. Thomas Jefferson said the world was for the living, so you were alive and they weren't.
That's what we thought. We didn't worry about the dead in that cemetery. We was right in the edge of it, and I stand guard in the middle of the night out there at times, but I didn't worry about the one in the cemetery. It's the ones that did over on the other side of the cemetery.
Two short stories on this section before we move on. I believe it was in this area that you were attacked a couple of times by German aircraft.
Yeah, we sure was. That was when we were laying artillery. Was the Germans was trying to get to us. They wanted to knock those out, and every morning about daylight, they start laying artillery on us. So they was unsuccessful in knocking us out with the artillery. We had dug in under these hedgerows, and they wasn't able to knock us out, and so they tried to get to us with the Air Force. And two different times they tried to get to us, and each time the anti-aircraft, American anti-aircraft, cut these planes down. One of them was hit and parachuted out right over the fence from us. But neither one of them was able to reach our position, thanks to our efficient anti-aircraft.
Fayne, we've got just 5 minutes left in this first segment. Another thing that you touched on a little bit a minute ago, one of the most discouraging and horrible sights that you witnessed was around St. Lo when you went up on that hill. Could you describe that? And then you were almost hit while you were on the hill.
Yeah, was one other boy and myself was up there, and you wonder why that we were even up there. We wasn't ordered up there. We went our own curiosity, you know. And we went up on the side of this hill. We went all the way around the hill, and and come back down, and that's where we saw all these boys. See, the infantry was poised there, ready to go over the hill and attack, and the Germans caught them with artillery in these a lot of trees there, and they got tree bursts that come right in on them, and just we had a tremendous destruction there. We lost an awful lot of boys there. We come on around, and then I think I had mentioned we heard something in this house, and we kicked the door in, went in the house, and we found there was a cow in the house.
But you got bombed about that time, didn't you? You had to dive for a pill box
yeah,
yourself?
Yeah, I did. I had, we had artillery shells on a continuing basis, but one of them in particular that I had, it had been raining very hard, and I had my glasses in my pocket, my bib pocket of my coveralls that we wore, and I dived into a foxhole to keep from getting hit, and I busted my glasses. So after that, I didn't have any glasses the rest of the time all the way through, but I could see real well without them, and I didn't complain, so I just went on and operated without the glasses.
When the troops broke through at St. Lo and started following Patton at that point, did you feel like that you were lucky to have survived? What kind of religious feelings did you have at this time? Did you feel like the worst was behind you, although for you, the worst was in front of you?
We didn't have any idea about the worst or the best, hardly, but if you were not religious, after you was through a few of those bumming things, you would get religion pretty quick. And I'd say, you know, I'd always gone to church from the time I was a small child, and I thought I was a good church member, but I really didn't know how to pray in earnest until we was in the foxholes. That's where we really learned to pray, and we did a lot of praying in the foxholes, that was for sure. I got the feeling before the war was over that absolutely the good Lord was with me, because he seemed to tell me which way to go each time, and I seemed to be the one surviving. And you get the feeling after a while that surely your time's about run out, you know, but you're still there and you still got to perform.
We'll conclude this part with one more question. You know that some of those shots you fired killed people. Did that bother you very much?
Well, I tell you, the way I looked at that, you know, way we thought about that, you know, we were peace-loving citizens, minding our own business. I didn't ask to go in the Army. I was drafted in the Army, and I was trained 20 months before I hit combat, and I thought it was my duty and obligation to do the job that I had been trained to do.
So after St. Lo, you felt pretty good about you could do your job.
Well, I felt pretty good about that I could do my job all along, because I had been trained so much in Texas. I went to this tank destroyer school, and I graduated there with honors from it, and I taught classes to the rest of the boys, and we fired on the firing range, and, you know, we were so well acquainted, and I could handle the gun so well, and I had confidence in handling that gun, that was for sure.
This concludes part one of our discussion with Fayne Haynes of Murfreesboro. In part two, we'll pick up with the Battle of Brest and Brittany, and then on through Paris, the Siegfried Line, the Battle of the Bulge, and his capture and time in a POW camp in Germany. Thank you very much for watching.
All aboard, we ain't a-goin' fishin'.